Hopefully we can make this a short break. I know that was an amazing presentation, and I'm like, oh, great. Now I get to follow it, but I have one thing I'm going to tell you about. It's the video. Everybody talked about the video. I'm going to refresh your memory. There were two videos. There was one that was made in the 70s, and it had this, I don't know if any of you have seen this one, it had this guy with this really long beard, and this one was actually made at NYU, and it was this, there was a woman with a colostomy in it, and she's like, yeah, I went to a bar, and I got picked up, and I got laid, and then the guy was like, he gave oral sex to this woman, and she was like, she was screaming like wild, and you could hear it across the street. And that's the video that was around in the 80s, the only video we had. And then I made a video, so I know the video well, but it was made in 1992. And just to refresh your memory, the key points of the video was there was a girl and a guy, Hector and Tiffany. And Hector and Tiffany were in the kitchen, and Hector was quad, and Tiffany had long blonde hair. And then remember, Hector like wheeled up and had oral sex with Tiffany when she was on the kitchen table. That was one key scene. And then there was the shower scene. And you remember the girl that, there was the guy and the girl, Mark Rosser and Lynn. We just found these people and, you know, she rolled them back in the wheelchair and they had sex and they had sex in the shower. And then there were the guy that, there was the thing there that we didn't talk about, and that's stuffing. You don't do stuffing anymore, where they actually talked about just stuffing their penis in. And I just want to say those, the tools outside and the dildos with the strap on, that's kind of a cool thing in terms of like the whole stuffing, because instead of stuffing, you could just put your penis inside the dildo. So just something about that. And I just had to tell you that I made the video that everybody was talking about with my husband, and Ben Vereen was in it, if you remember that. I don't know if anybody saw it. And that was really cool because he used to sit in my office with me at night, and we made this video together. We were talking about it and stuff. It was pretty cool. So back to sustaining sexuality. And now is kind of the more fun part of this. And I think, you know, if anything, everybody here, you've all emphasized this. I want to say everybody should give a hand to Angela because she has done an amazing job getting everybody here. And all the participants, everybody telling us their intimate secrets, which is amazing and how much we've learned from that. And it all boils down, though, to one thing, and that is, in a lot of ways, communication. I think we heard a lot about how important communication is. And even if you have a disability, you can be better than that guy that's walking. Because that's one of the things when the guys in our video said, Joe Davis said, he's like, yeah, they know once they had that wheelchair man, they don't want a non-wheelchair man. Because there's something special for women about the whole issue of communication, especially. But when you really bring it out, I mean, it's not just women, it's women and men, and we communicate in different ways. And this is what I want to say is important for professionals, and especially doctors. You know, we communicate when we think, when we listen, if we actually listen to our patients. We communicate non-verbally. You know, if you're making a face, if I'm looking at you weird, you're not going to want to tell me about what's going on. And then obviously we communicate by speaking. So one thing I think that people also emphasized was your comfort level. How comfortable we are with our own sexuality affects the way other people are in terms of talking to us about sex. And this goes from one level to the other. You know, you get the little kiddo here with the tampons. I will tell you this story. When I was a little kid, I had an aunt that was a nun, and I couldn't swim. So I went to the store, and you know they have like athletic supporters, aka jock straps? I went to the drugstore with my mom and my aunt the nun, and I said, this is what I need. I need one of these. Can I have one? And they all just laughed at me. Obviously, they were not comfortable communicating about sex. And it's part of life. If you don't feel comfortable, use your audio visuals. There is a new movie from Mayo Clinic that can be used now. There's no sex in it. It's just talking. It's not as fun, but you can use that video or discussion groups or see Mitch Tepper's videos online. But we need to teach people to ask questions and talk. But then this is really the area which we have to look into, and that's the pre-existing sexual issues. Again, people have primary sexual dysfunctions. There are people that just are naturally inhibited. or have sexual concerns just from, you know, the time of birth. They might have been abused. People that have a history of sexual abuse have a hard time with it their whole lives. And imagine having a spinal cord injury on top of it. We're different ages. You heard everyone here was kind of about the same age. They were pretty young at their injury. But if you took the, you know, that 15, 16-year-old and the 60-year-old, there's a difference. Everybody's got coming into this, you know, into this play from a different position. And then the issue of relationship. Do you have a partner? Sometimes maybe it's better to have a partner. And sexual orientation. We haven't really talked about sexual orientation a lot, but that's a big thing. If you are homosexual or bisexual or have had a gender change, you know, it's a whole nother level of difficulty in terms of dealing with sexual issues that, and not all professionals are comfortable with that. You know, the professional is the person too that's sitting there. If they're going to make a face at you, you're going to have an even harder time. And then there's the issue of other illnesses. And I forgot, I can walk around. The issue of other illnesses and how other illnesses impact you. And, you know, high blood pressure. High blood pressure gives you problems with sexual issues. Depression. We heard someone talk about depression and how all they had going on was the fact that they were depressed about their injury. They weren't ready to care about their sex lives. Diabetes. People with diabetes get sexual dysfunction. Can you all hear me okay? Okay, good. Epilepsy, too. People who have epilepsy take... Okay, they take medicine for it, and this medicine affects their sexual function. And then we know what's so prominent in our country now, especially is drug addiction, especially opiate addiction, and alcohol. All these issues affect your sexual function. So if somebody's coming in with a spinal cord injury and they've had these problems going on in their lives before the injury, it makes it that much harder. So it's really important. It's really important when you're working with someone, ask them if they had problems before their injury. Ask them if there were issues before their illness. And also, we're talking mainly about spinal cord injury, but pretty much the same issues that impact people physiologically with spinal cord injury also affect them with spinal cord disorders. The only difference is, you know, how the injury was happening, and one group might have an ongoing disorder, one group might not. All right, so pre-existing illness issues and sexual status, I've talked about these. One, two is chronic pain. Definitely chronic pain is a major cause of sexual problems in and of itself. And with all the medications we give people for chronic pain, many of those medications actually cause sexual dysfunction. Just think about the fact that, you know, we all hear about the opiate addiction crisis. Opiates, if you take opiates, 3 months after you're taking opiates, your balls are going to shrink. Think about it. Women have menstrual problems. Your testosterone goes down, and testosterone is what makes you want to have sex. I'm sorry, that's my firm, you know, that's the number one thing. Testosterone, yeah, you want to have sex. Vascular disease. People with vascular disease. What's your penis? What's your clitoris? What's going on in your vagina? Blood flow. You got problems in your blood vessels in one place, you got problems in your blood vessels in another place. So all these issues get combined, and we have to think about the pre-existing illness. The other issue is cultural issues. Different cultures deal with sex in different ways. I am Catholic, and I was told that, you know, it's a sin to masturbate, and you're not supposed to, you know, you're supposed to use rhythm for birth control, and you're not supposed to have sex before you're married. And I am Catholic, and I probably did all those bad things. I'm sure I did all those bad things. But the point is that I actually unlearned that in medical school. I really did. When I watched these videos, I mean, I learned, okay, I got permission to do things. And getting permission from someplace else is an important thing for many people. If we think about other things that go on, though, in the world, what about female circumcision or female genital mutilation? We're talking about, you know, this is a major thing. And then I'm looking at women, and you're looking at women. We're saying, okay, you know, I'll go have an orgasm or that sort of thing. Well, I had a conversation with someone at lunchtime, and what's your last name?
Dr. Shahid.
And he worked in Saudi Arabia for a few years and explained to me that in different countries, they don't even have a word for orgasm. So if there's no word for it, and, you know, we have a disadvantage as women in a little bit because, you know, you see the penis, you see it's big, and then it gets small, and then, you know, so you kind of, you got that part down. Women have a harder time. So there's all these cultural issues that go on. And then in some cultures, there's associated with, there's the issue of, well, there's the issue of dress we're aware of and how different people dress differently. Also the issue of male dominance versus female dominance. If you're getting into a situation where you're the person, you're the one that's putting on the circus, as you said, but that's a change. There's a pre-existing sexual issues. You've got to deal with the change of what's going on. Who was on top? Who was on the bottom? You know, how are all these things happening culturally for you? And in some cultures, it's not okay to have sex with somebody that's disabled. You take care of people. You don't play with them. You don't. So we talked about how spinal cord injury affects sexual response. We talked about, what was the thing I taught you? Pockets to the belly button, okay? Pockets to the belly button is whether you have psychogenic responses, both lubrication and erection. And then the bulbocavernosus and that sacral area there, whether people have rectal sensation and whether they have rectal reflexes, really, if they have them, then they're hopefully good to go in terms of having orgasms. And there we go with the little pocket thing. And above T10 with spasticity, you have reflexes. Below T10, it depends on what's happening in your pockets to your belly button. And orgasm is possible or not, depending on where the injury is. So how do we sustain sexuality? Just a couple points here. If I have a spinal cord injury and I can't feel, how can I have an orgasm? That is a big question that comes up. And the thing that we need to understand is that orgasms are internal. They're not external. You don't have them on the outside of your body. You have them inside. Next time you are involved sexually, don't think about it until after. But they're a reflex. They're a reflex. That's, you know, in some ways, I think that's why vibrators work so well for people, because it's targeted. You get the reflex. And there's actually a reflex called the vibratory reflux, and you can kind of look in this. And orgasms can occur without ejaculation. People do have non-genital orgasms, and that is known. It's less common. It's not my area of expertise, but it does happen in able-bodied people and spinal cord injured person. And one thing I just want to send home to you guys is there has been research done in fMRI and PET scan research done. And in a PET scan, this one guy named Janico Georgiadis did this fabulous study where he took 40 people and he put them in the PET scan. And he showed them having orgasms in the PET scan. And he had them like faking orgasms and then having real orgasms. And what he showed was that when people have orgasms, the front part of their brain, the frontal lobe, the part with executive function where you plan and you organize, that quiets down. So it's kind of like you get to shut your brain off. And what happens is there's increased activity then in your cerebellum and your lower in your brainstem area. So again, it's a great way for people to relax. And with relaxation in terms of spinal cord, there's the issue of decreasing spasticity afterwards. In terms of the sustaining sexuality, though, a key is not to forget the partner. The partner's got a big part of this. If the person's wanting sex and the partner isn't, that's a problem. And you've got to really think about that. Having no partner can be a significant drawback for people in a wheelchair. And this is, again, from Streetsy, which I just love their pictures. And what it says is this woman's leaning over and saying, I've never been kissed. It's not that I don't want to. It's just that nobody else does. So I think this really emphasizes the issue of loneliness. And that's something that we really haven't studied after spinal cord injury. You know, loneliness is an issue, and hopefully some of the internet-based things and, you know, opening people's communication will work to change that. So how do I know what works? Only way, when you're, just like people have said, you know, being reborn again, that's the way I like to describe it. It's like You know, it's like you're going through puberty again. You're going through adolescence. You need to try and see what works. And I think it's best to try alone. You know, practice. This says, are you ready for your big date? And the guy says, yes, sir, I've been feeling myself up all day for practice, and I'm getting real good at it. So practice makes perfect. I think you don't want perfect, but practice, you know, practice makes comfortable. And we want to be comfortable. We want to feel good about things. And, you know, again, practicing alone or, and this is this men's vibrator that I just, you know, if anybody tries one when they go home, send me an email and tell me how it works, because it looks really, this just looks really cool when you look at it online. It's only like $60. You know, there's three different buttons, so I think you could press all three and get different sensations. I don't have stock in this vibrator. Or with a partner. You could also practice, obviously, practice with a partner. But, you know, as people have talked about, the issue of communicating with your partner is a big deal. And one of the things about communicating is that issue of the bladder and the bowel. And, you know, that was the thing that happened in my video was Hector and Tiffany when they were having sex, and this just randomly happened. Hector, like, had a bladder accident. He's like, uh-oh, bladder accident, and he pulls out the urinal. And but that's, like, what they just learned as part of their sexual activity was, you know, keep something handy. It might not be that, you know, Mitch Tepper had that great sheet on his bed. You know, that was really sexy and cool. But, you know, whatever you got, I guess you could just use a glass cup if you're just dealing with, you know, the easy way to do it. And then, you know, trying out other new toys, the battery, not battery operated, iPhone operated vibrator might be something that's interesting and basic. And then in terms of sustaining sexuality, we've got to follow up. And I think this is my last slide. This is my last slide. Just because the way this is supposed to work, it doesn't mean that's the way it's going to work. That's kind of the reality. It's the reality for all of us. And I'm going to go through this. And let me just confirm that. Maybe it's not my last slide. Medications. Medications can cause sexual dysfunction. And if people in this room have never had any of these experiences, you will probably have one of these experiences, either by yourself or either by your partner in your lifetime. I'm pretty sure with all the medicines we give away. Narcotics. I said that before. 3 months of narcotics, balls are going to shrink. Testosterone's going to go down. Testosterone goes down, you don't want to have sex. It's just kind of what happens. Antidepressants. I don't know how many friends I could tell you that I have who would say that, you know, yeah, their husband's taking antidepressants now, or they're taking antidepressants, and they just don't have sex really anymore. And the other thing about antidepressants, though, is for men especially, like SSRIs, men get SSRIs for premature ejaculation. So the opposite happens. So they make out hard, but they'll be doing it and doing it and doing it and just never coming. So this has nothing to do with having a spinal cord injury. So this is just if you're able-bodied. So if this happens when you're able-bodied, then take the fact that you have a spinal cord injury, and not only do we give you antidepressants, but we also gave you antispasticity drugs, and you got to worry about your bladder on your bowel and your spasticity and moving around in bed. So you got to think about all these issues, and if your patients or people you know have these issues, go through them one by one. And my message is really I want to empower people to take control of this. Is if I want to have a good sex life and do this, I want to have the power to be able to ask for it. Antispasticity medicines, the more baclofen you take, the less erection you have. It just kind of works that way. And it works that way for women, too. And that's why with intrathecal baclofen, I'm not really a proponent for that because it's been shown to have problems with intrathecal baclofen, too. The other thing about antispasticity medicines is, interestingly, for priapism, one of the other treatments people have given for priapism is baclofen. So just the way it is. Antihypertensives cause sexual dysfunction in people. And last year, just a friend of mine, a person with a spinal cord injury, has been injured for years, you know, has been having, he's a well, you know, big person out there, he's got a lot of different girlfriends. He calls me up and he's like, just call me up to talk to me about his sex life. And what has happened? He's had sex for years, fine, with his spinal cord injury. But then his doctor changed his medicine. So what happens? He gave him a beta blocker, and so he went from being fine with his sexuality and spinal cord injury to now having problems. And this has happened 20, 30 years down the pike. So these kind of things affect able-bodied people and spinal cord injured people. Bladder medications and anti-seizure meds. You know, what we do, probably, I think, the number one and number two drug that I see other people use for neurogenic pain is gabapentin. Anybody see patients on gabapentin? Lyrica? We use those drugs a lot. You know, you can see them on TV all the time, especially Lyrica for diabetic nerve pain. Well, they both cause sexual dysfunction too. So pretty much all these medicines we're giving people are having negative side effects on their sex lives, with that exception of the midodrine there, which is like apparently works really well, and the testosterone. All those medicines are like, whew. And that's the last side, so I'm going to go back one more. I want to just talk about some other issues because I think they're important, and you're going to have to bear with me. If you feel sick, you don't want to have sex. That's the bottom line, right? I mean, other things get in the way. Other illnesses, other injuries get in the way. And with those other illnesses, there is a big factor in terms of how you're communicated to. And I'm gonna tell you a story because you will remember this probably. So I said I had cancer before. The thing I didn't tell you was I was driving home from work and I had like this biopsy, and it was just when I became the president of the American Spinal Injury Association. And I get this phone call from my doctor, my previous doctor, who says to me, I get to take a piece of your cervix. Think about it. He actually said this to me. He knew I was a doctor. He had delivered my baby. Obviously, I never went back to that doctor. But you talk about communication, and you talk about the whole issue and how all interacts together. Other medical problems are very significant in terms of sexual issues. So look at the whole person. Don't just look at a little bit, and don't say stupid shit. That was, you know, I mean, I immediately went to a different doctor and that sort of thing, and someday I'll write about this in a book that I've been writing for 5 years, but, you know, how horrible can somebody be to another person to say something like that? What does he say to his, you know, non-physician patients? God. So, family, we talked about family, the fact that when you got a family involved, it makes things harder, and you think about those other variables. That room in Sinai, you know, you have to be, you could be there, but you probably couldn't be yourself because you had to watch what you were saying. Think about the issues of depression. Think about the issues of loneliness. And then, most importantly, think about the issue of partners. And if you put all this together, I think you can get a good picture for what's going on with people. And hopefully, what you learned today would not just help you with your patients with spinal cord injuries, but also you can take this home for yourselves and, you know, whoever else you want to talk to about it. And that's all I want to say.
Thank you.